Okay. Think that should work now. Okay, so welcome to my presentation now. My name is Christian. I'm based at the UK Biochar Research Center here in Edinburgh. And I will talk today about synergies in sequential biochar systems. So in contrast to Wolfram's presentation, I will have less pictures and more dry stuff because I'm talking about concepts and systems. But yeah, let's see how that goes. So a little bit of an overview. So I will give you a quick overview about the state of biochar research, about biochar systems before I get into my topic of sequential biochar systems. And after that, I will talk about experimental validation. Just give me a second so I can see if you can hear me. Yeah, okay. Seems to be fine. Is it working? So, about biochar research. So we all know there's a lot of interest in biochar in the last decade. So as we can see, the number of publications increased quite rapidly. So more people are looking into that, and more knowledge is accumulated. And not only about the traditional applications, like Wolfram talked about as a soil amendment or generally in agriculture, but also in more in a broader field of different applications, for example, in catalysis as an additive in building materials, in electrochemical applications, or for gas filtration, wastewater filtration. So quite a wide variety of different applications are now under research. And as Wolfram also touched, there is not one biochar, so you can still say there are some general characteristics. So now on a really broad level, so when I talk about biochar, I mean, I'm talking about not one material, but a certain class of different materials. One factor of biochar is that they are all solid materials with a stable carbon skeleton. And by definition, they are produced for long-term carbon sequestration. So there are different definitions out there in the academic literature. But in general, we would say that it should be used for carbon sequestration. And we can also accept that biochar properties will change over time or according to their usage. And we all know this famous picture of the biochar cycle, so how we actually want to sequester carbon. And because we have a lot of ongoing discussions about climate change, I put in some numbers from a publication last year. So we all know the Paris climate target of 1.5%. And with the current pledges of all the countries, we already quite far behind this target, so around 26 to 29 gigatons of CO2 equivalents are missing. And on the other hand, we know that biochar would have the potential to sequester somewhere between 13 and 23 gigatons of CO2 equivalent in the same period, so until 2030. The wide range is dependent on what kind of feedstocks you use, if you actually use plantation biomass or not. However, the important stuff is that actually we have a technology that is more or less ready to be used, but we don't see it in real life as much as we want. So the overall question would be, why is the climate not safe yet? And as you all know, living in a capitalist world as we do, the economics have to be right. And all of us are somehow interested in biochar. And as we know, there's not a lot about economics in biochar systems. And as Wolfram said before, biochar is really context dependent. So it has different cost structures locally, within a region and even more between countries and different feedstock types. But I want to go a little bit further out of this, more on a conceptual level, so away from case studies and more on the broad use concept of biochar. And if you look into the literature, you find around more or less these four biochar systems that we can rely on right now. And I will give them a short overview of what they are. So, for example, the first one is the typical pyrolysis biochar soil system. So that's the most basic system, which is shown here as a simplified scheme. So what this means is you take your waste biomass, should be waste biomass, produce a biochar, you sell it to a farmer, and then you put it in, he puts it into the soil and you get carbon sequestration. The money bags here that Christian wanted to see, they symbolize costs or revenues. So the red money bag symbolizes that to use biochar, you actually have to have costs related to that, so production and feedstock costs. And the green money bags means when you sell your biochar, you get money back as in relation to its fertilizer value, so what the farmer pays you. And in the original concept, you had something like a carbon price in there. So 10 years ago, we all thought that governments will pay biochar producers to actually sequester carbon, so either pay the farmer or the biochar producer. However, as we now know, no one is actually paying for that. And even the systems that are in place to offset negative carbon emissions, usually somewhere between 20 and 80 euro per ton, although they don't include biochar, but just to give you an idea of the range that we are currently paying for sequestering CO2. And as this publication from our colleague Simon Sheckley showed, for biochar to have large scale effects, so that you start large scale projects in Europe to apply biochar into soil, you would need at least around 200 euro per ton. So we are far away from getting the economics right of this simple system. However, there are still some advantages. So in this normal simple system, you use biochar solely for soil carbon sequestration, so you don't use any carbon on the way. And it is already economical in niche markets. So for example, in household gardening, which means you sell biochar soil mixtures in 10 liter bags, you get quite a good price. And in this context, it can be economical. However, the disadvantages from the economic side for this system is that the production price always determines your minimum market price. So the minimum price you can sell your biochar is your production price, because no biochar producer will sell its product below its production price and making no profit. So after the after this system more or less failed a little bit or got problems, can you still hear me? Yeah, okay. There was a shift to something called the biochar value cascade system, which you can see here, a scheme of it. That actually means that you have a value cascade, which is an economic unit. For example, the original setting was a farm setup. So you're a farmer, you buy some biochar, but you don't, you not only use it as a soil amendment, but you use it for composting, for animal bedding, as an animal feed, for a whole bunch of different applications to get more value out of your biochar. So you solve more problems, more than one problem at a time by buying biochar. And after that, you either apply it to soil or indirectly through composting and then to soil. And the catchphrase that Hans-Peter Schmidt used was, use it 9 times, pay it only once. And there are some advantages for this concept. So for example, that it uses the multifunctional nature of biochar. So more than one property of biochar was used. For example, there are different properties for biochar as animal feed, then as a soil amendment. And there was a paradigm shift beyond the traditional use of biochar. So the research started to use it for different kind of applications. However, the disadvantages, the system is quite static, so you only produce one biochar and use it for different things. However, that makes it impossible to optimize its properties for each application, because you cannot optimize for seven different properties at the same time. And again, the same disadvantages with the first setup is that your production price is still the minimum biochar price. So you cannot be lower than the production price. So, and then something Wolfram touched on is engineering biochar, which means tailoring the biochar properties for specific applications. So you have different pre, post processing steps. You have additives, we just saw wood ash, for example. But mostly engineered biochars now, or what I mean with this term, are used for high value applications. So for example, water filtration, gas filtration, or electrochemical applications. So you find biochars that are chemically activated, for example, with a lot of chemical waste stream. You have rare earth elements as additives to produce a catalyst support, whatever you have. And this means that there's a shifting focus in engineering biochar, what you can see now in research, because for high value applications, you usually have a traditional competing material, which is in a lot of cases activated carbon. It's sometimes from renewable sources like coconuts, but mostly from fossil coal. And the problem is that it's highly efficient. It's not sustainable, but it's highly efficient. So what research is trying to do is increasing the single-use efficiency of biochar to be able to compete with the traditional materials. And one of the disadvantages of this is that the focus on carbon sequestration gets lost. So as I said before, for example, the addition of rare earth elements is not really sustainable anymore, because they have a higher carbon footprint than the biochar can ever offset, for example. And additionally, usually the researchers don't look after the application anymore. So there's no demand for carbon sequestration in the research. So it's really just about the application rather than the whole lifetime efficiency. However, the advantage is that engineered biochars can sometimes outperform traditional materials. And the disadvantage, as I said, there's no focus on carbon sequestration. If you look at papers for engineered biochars, usually they stop after showing how well they behave in an application, and that's it. And then there's the last system I want to touch on, which is the filter to fertilizer system, which means you use a biochar as a filter medium for some nutrient-rich waste streams, for example, wastewater. You filter out the contaminant, for example, phosphorus or nitrogen. And if you change the environment of your biochar, so you take your filter out, put it into soil, the former contaminant becomes a nutrient, which actually is a win-win situation, because you decrease the contaminant in one situation, change the environment, and then you have a nutrient-enriched biochar in the other environment. However, the same disadvantage as always, we still cannot get cheaper than the production price with the minimum price of biochar, which we also heard before. The production price is still the main obstacle for biochar to be used at large scale. And additionally, it's only applicable for specific waste streams. So to sum that up, there are some obstacles of existing concepts. First of all, none of them really uses the multifunctional nature of biochar. So they all assume quite static biochar properties that do not really change throughout their system. And they are all based on simple product scheme, which I will touch on in a couple of minutes. So, which means that the production price determines the minimum viable price, and high value concepts tend to forget carbon sequestration and instead focus on single use efficiency. So, and this brings me to my research objectives for actually looking into sequential biochar systems. So my aim is to reconceptualize biochar systems with a focus on this multifunctional nature of biochar. And my other aim is to decouple the minimum price for biochar from its production costs. So to find a way to lower the price for biochar without actually lowering the production cost of it. So the idea of a sequential biochar systems, you can see a scheme here. It's pretty simple. You produce a biochar, use it for an application, then you use it for a different application, before it ends up in the soil as a carbon sequestration tool. And the idea behind that, I will go into detail in a second, is based on the main characteristic of biochar, which is it's a stable carbon material. So the first thing you could think about if you know your carbon stays for 100 years the same, more or less, the carbon structure, is why not recycling biochar to increase its lifetime? Because the carbon structure will more or less stay the same, so there should be an option of recycling biochar. And the other idea was that with sequencing of different applications, you can actually put together or match different applications in a sequence to allow a stepwise use of the multifunctional nature, so of different properties, because each application will require different properties from a biochar. So how does it look from an economic point of view? On top you see the traditional system, and on the bottom a sequential biochar system, just as a comparison. The idea is to have production costs and then have a series of different revenues for your biochar. And if you have a series of revenues, which means you sell your biochar several times, you can actually distribute your production feedstock costs, which only occur once, over your whole sequence. So you can put 30% of the cost to your first use, 30% to the second, and 30% to the 40% to the third use. And that means you can actually lower your selling price below your production costs. So that sounds good, but there's one catch phrase factor here, so which is the importance of ownership. So if we think how can we actually lower the production price? If you think about existing concepts, which is for example the value cascade concept, you have your biochar producer and you sell it to your user, and the user uses it multiple times. The other concept would be you produce your biochar, you sell it to a user, and the user sells it to the next user. However, in both concepts, there cannot be a reduction in the initial price for biochar, because the producer is disconnected from the user. That means the producer has to get all his value back when he sells his product. So there's no way to avoid that the producer sells his product above the production price. So how can we change that? We can change that if we start to rethink how we look at biochar. If we frame biochar not as a traditional product, but more as a carrier for environmental services, we can actually change the cost structure. So I will try to give an example of that. So let's assume you are a biochar company. You produce a biochar and you have the normal production and feedstock costs, and you have a user that needs a filter for wastewater filtration. What you do in the context of a sequential biochar system would be to sell the service of wastewater filtration by renting out your biochar. So you sell the service of wastewater filtration. After your biochar filter is exhausted, you take the material back and get the money from the company who used who was in need for wastewater filtration. And you can do that multiple times. And the important thing is that because you stay the owner of the biochar over your whole sequence, you can actually distribute the production cost. That's the only way to lower the initial costs for the first customer below the production costs if you know that you will get the revenue later on. There's another thing you have to take in mind when you talk about sequential biochar systems, which is that in most cases you will need some treatment between your applications. So, which I would call a recycling treatment, which means you have your application, you take your exhausted biochar filter back, and then it will be contaminated with whatever you filtered out of the water. So you have to transport your biochar back to your treatment facility, treat it, and then transport it to the next user. And the question is, how can you be more efficient than actually producing new biochar with the same efficiency? So if your recycling step is cheaper, this whole sequence, then producing new biochar, you're actually on a better track than before. And to give a hint, if that's possible, you can see on the left the breakdown of the costs for biochar production at a large scale in the UK. So that's all already from 2011. However, it's just about the magnitude of costs. And you can see the production costs of fresh biochar are mainly determined by the feedstock costs. So if you think about that the recycling treatment will be something similar to a production treatment, but you don't have to pay for the feedstock, you can see that there's quite a big opportunity for being more efficient. And additionally to this flexibility or to this possible profit you can make, you have some additional advantages of using a sequential system, which means if you know how your biochar will be used over the whole sequence, you can actually use flexible pricing, which means the first user might pay less than he would have to if you count in the full price. But you don't want him to, because you can sell more if you go down with the price, and you need more of the biochar for the second use, for example. What you can do is actually adjusting the mass flows between your within your sequence as you want. So if you have a third use, which is highly profitable, you can make the first two cheaper to put more biochar in the third use, for example. And that is also the same concept as why you can lower your initial biochar price lower than the production price. It's just about calculating your whole sequence upfront. Just take a short thing if everything is fine. Okay. So what you can ask then is what are suitable applications for sequential uses? So you cannot really use all different applications. So as Wolfram said, for example, if you adsorb heavy metals, you don't want to use that anymore because you won't get them off, and heavy metals you cannot break them down. So I put the suitable applications in three different categories. One is the contaminant to nutrient category, like the filter to fertilizer setup. For example, you filter phosphorus, nitrogen, or sulfur, load it on your biochar, and then use it as a nutrient, which is the win-win situation. Then you have the second scenario where you have a contaminant that you have to decontaminate before you can use a biochar again, which, for example, can be organic pollutants like emerging micropollutants, so pharmaceuticals, personal care products, where you can apply a recycling treatment to degrade them and then use your biochar again. And then you have the third category, which you can call process enhancement. So you put your biochar as an additive to some process to increase its performance, which we know from co-composting or anaerobic digestion. So to identify this, you basically just have to match the pre and post application properties of your biochar. So what properties does the biochar need for the application and what properties does it have after your application with possible recycling steps to match these two. And then you can juggle around with different applications to find a suitable sequence that is usable. However, unfortunately, there's almost no research done on post-use properties. So you find only a handful of paper that looks at the properties of biochar after the application, for example, in wastewater filtration or gas filtration. And there are even less paper on recycling treatments. So, which is good for researchers because you can do a lot of research in this area, but bad if you want to build a sequential biochar system. And just a picture of how that can look, how you try to match different applications. So now just really short as a last slide, I think. So I'm not only trying to build a concept and say that it works. So I'm also testing one of my sequences. So what I'm working on is I produced some mineral biochar composites and used it for micropollutant removal. Developed a recycling step using a hydrothermal treatment, and then used the same biochar, so the treated biochar, for biogas purification for the filtration of hydrogen sulfide. The hydrogen sulfide will be absorbed in the form of elemental sulfur on the biochar, and then you put that in the compost and end up with a sulfur-loaded biochar or sulfur-loaded compost. And so that's the idea, and right now, so I'm at the biogas purification stage with my colleague Sabina, which will present next week, I think. Maybe she can tell more about that. So as some takeaway messages, what I want to show you is that biochar is more than a simple material, and it makes sense to think about the concept on a meta-conceptual level about biochar. So if you start to see biochar as a carrier for environmental services, there it opens up new research questions and also new opportunities, both in a research way or in an academic way, as well as in an economic way. So for example, the whole recycling biochar area is really under research right now, because in our normal concepts, it doesn't make any sense. So when you reconceptualize, you find opportunities that didn't exist before. Yeah. So that was my talk. And now, because I didn't see anything, I hope you heard me. And I'm open for questions now.